I am very happy to have my Dharma sister and Dharma brother from Musangsa in Korea visit us. So, Soya, Sunim is from Russia, and tonight we'll have a discussion with her and Dharma sharing with her. I think originally Soya Sunim, she started to practice meditation when she was 18 years old. And she comes from a part of Russia that is called Samara. And when she told me, I didn't know where it was either, but it's southwest of Moscow. How many miles?
Southeast.
Southeast of Moscow.
1,000 kilometers.
How many meters?
1,000 kilometers.
1,000 kilometers southeast of Moscow. So usually when nowadays we have this kind of conversation, I usually like to ask the question, what brought you to practice meditation?
Well, actually, many different reasons. So, like, on the one hand, I think, since I remember by myself, it's I always knew that I'm not gonna do what like people usually tell you you're supposed to do in your life. Like, go to school, finish school, go to university, finish university, get a job, make children, die. So, and completely didn't make any sense to me. So I always knew that I'm not gonna do that, but I had no idea what am I supposed to do if not that. So I was kind of always looking for something. So I actually studied a lot of kind of religion and philosophy already in high school. And also there were a lot of, at that time Russia was pretty kind of in crisis. So it was like the end of the Soviet Union and the revolution. And many people were suffering strongly. But at some point it was very clear that actually what makes people suffer, and I also observed that in myself, that it's not the situation, but our attitude to the situation. Like, I was pretty aware of the fact that like my own thinking makes me happy or unhappy, not the situation that I find myself in. So naturally, of course, I wondered what to do with this thinking, how to deal with it or how to control it. And basically my brother started going to some kung fu place, and the teacher there, he was also teaching meditation. And at first I looked at him and I thought that there's some kind of strange cult because he was very demanding in training and stuff. But then my brother brought home two sutras, and actually three sutras. It was Heart Sutra and one text by famous Korean monk, Won Hyo Sunim, maybe you have heard. It's called Admonition to Beginners, I think. Or sometimes they call it also inspiring yourself into practice. Okay. I don't know how it's in Korean.
Yeah, okay.
But that's a very powerful text, actually. If somebody misses inspiration to practice or motivation to practice, you should read it sometimes. And the third was Xinjin Mei. I'm not sure how it is in Chinese. It's the third Chinese patriarch, Zen Master Seung Sahn. It's called The Song of the Faith in Mind. And that sutra, it was like so, it made everything so clear. It's pretty famous, maybe you read it. There's like famous phrase from it. The great way is not difficult if there's no like and dislike, no repulsion or attachment. And then it goes on like this. So yeah, once I read it, I decided to go and practice meditation.
So, but making the decision to practice and then finding somebody to practice with or finding a teacher, was that easy or difficult?
Well, I didn't have to look for somebody to practice because my brother was already practicing.
Yeah, I mean like a teacher to follow.
So first I just followed this Kung Fu teacher.
Yeah.
But then it appeared that he's a little bit screwed up. And actually, thanks to this, I found like a real Zen master, because there was he did some strange things, and it was a big scandal on the internet. And because of this, we got to know that to Ukraine actually was coming Zen Master Kaisen. It's a French man, but teaching Japanese Soto Zen, tradition. So finally, after like 4.5 years practicing with this Kung Fu teacher, I started practicing in Soto Zen.
So then you went to France?
Well, I kept going back and forth.
Back and forth. Uh-huh.
Because I cannot stay in France as a Russian citizen.
So how did you support yourself or keep yourself going while you were like going back and forth, because it must be very difficult to hold down a permanent job at that time?
Well, you don't have to have a permanent job. So basically any place where I was at and where I could stay for at least little while, it's possible to find some kind of temporary job. Mostly it's like cleaning houses or, I don't know, carrying stuff from delivery or something like. In Russia, there's a lot of job like this that they pay you every day, basically, once your job is done. And then they don't expect you to stay there until you die. So it's not so difficult.
So you worked and saved enough money, then once you had enough money, then you would go back to France to practice.
Well, basically, I tried to go to all the retreats that were there. Actually, I became a nun shortly after I started practicing with him, and as a nun or a monk, you're supposed to attend all the retreats. So basically, it was not that first I work and earn enough money and go. It's like first I decide to go and then I work to earn enough money.
So to enable you to continue going, you had to earn money.
Yeah, of course. Basically, in like Europe, it doesn't matter whether you're monk or layperson, you have to earn money and pay for a retreat, because there's nobody's going to just give you money for...
Not like in Asia.
Yeah, not like in Asia.
Anybody, any questions? No? No question at all?
Yeah, so during the practice, must be the people around there, how do they treat people that practice meditation, like monks and nuns?
How they treat monks and nuns in Europe?
People where?
In the West?
Where you stay, where you practice.
In Russia?
Russia.
Well, generally, they're very curious about what it's like to be a monk or a nun. And so it's something a little bit unusual. But on the other hand, it's not like in Asia. For example, so in Asia, basically, you put on this kind of clothes, you shave the head, everybody's going to be like, oh, I'm it. In Russia, they judge you by what you do. Like, if you deserve respect, they're going to give you respect. But if in their eyes you don't deserve the respect, they don't care what kind of status you have, what kind of title you have. It really doesn't matter. So basically, it's the most important. It's like what you do for them. Like if they see that you kind of organize something for them, like lead meditation, help them, inspire them, then people can be very generous and supportive and kind of grateful. But if you just walk around and like I'm a nun. They're just going to think that you're an idiot. That's basically what they think usually in this case.
So while you were being a nun in Europe and Russia, did you find that there were some challenging experiences that you had to go through to continue this kind of life that you've chosen?
Well, basically, it was challenging all the time.
It was challenging all the time.
Wow. Yeah, because like you basically sometimes you just have nothing to eat because
really?
Because well, mostly like my because we kind of started opening Zen centers very quickly. Mm. So first year we opened Zen center in my native city in Samara. Mm. Then there was one nun who came to Russia. She was supposed to kind of guide the. There was almost no Buddhism in Russia at that time. No Zen, at least. There was one Kwanum Zen center in St. Petersburg.
Russia is mostly an Orthodox.
Orthodox,
Muslim, Christian-Muslim country.
Yeah. A lot of Muslims and Tibetan Buddhism.
Tibetan Buddhism.
Yeah.
Okay, so then this nun came.
And she was like, we're going to go open Zen center in Moscow. And I was like, you're crazy. Like, you have no money, no place to stay, no job. Like, we don't know anybody there. And she was like, it's a capital. We have to have a Zen center in the capital. And then she tells me, like, you go and you prepare everything. Then I come and we organize, like, the introduction into meditation. And then, so you find a place for introduction for meditation, find a place where we're going to live, and find a place where we're going to have regular practice for the Zen center. And it was like that most of the time, actually.
Wow.
But so, somehow
you survive.
Always, like, something appears if you try.
So you were practicing in Europe and Russia. Then how did this connection to Korea appear? I mean, you know, it's quite far away and, you know.
Yeah, but basically, actually, my first teacher who was teaching Kung Fu and Zen, he started practicing in Kwanum.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but yeah. Then...
Kwanum is our school, right? Kwanum School of Zen.
Kwanum School of Zen, yeah.
Yeah.
But then he went a little bit cuckoo. And I didn't know that at that time because I knew nothing about Zen and meditation. So for a few years, it was okay.
Yeah.
But there was already this connection. So he was teaching us. He had a lot of books of Musangsa, Sunim in English, and actually, like he gave them all to me because nobody else could read English. So I read them, and then when we came to enter open Zen center in St. Petersburg after Moscow, there was a Kwanum Zen center also, and they actually helped us very much.
Right.
And then there were Zen masters
coming
to St. Petersburg, so I was kind of always curious. But at first I thought, like, no, I'm not going to go, because, like, I already have a teacher. I don't want to, like, see all these Korean teachers. But then so one time Wu Bong Sunim, he was coming to Petersburg for a 10-day retreat. And I wanted to go and just... because I was curious, but then I thought, no, I have to go to Moscow, earn money, and go for a retreat in France. So I came to Moscow, and I used to stay at my friend's house. They open the door, and they tell me, and Wu Bong Sunim is coming in 3 hours.
Wu Bong Sunim is Zen Master Wu Bong.
Yeah, Zen Master Wu Bong.
Zen Master, a teacher in our school, yeah.
Yeah, so we spent 1 week in one house with him, no matter how I tried to escape. And after that, I kind of started going for quantum retreats sometimes. But basically, if you practice in Europe, there's no opportunity to have like long term retreats.
There's no opportunity to have a long retreat.
It's impossible to organize, at least in our sangha. It was impossible because it's too expensive and people have to work. And but at some point, I started feeling that I actually need this kind of more intensive meditation practice because I had to actually teach people meditation, lead retreats and stuff. But you know, you cannot do it if your level is not good enough. At some point, you just start feeling like you're talking bullshit to people, you know.
Right.
So finally, I decided to go for kyolche to Korea. And then I went for one kyolche, and then another one, and another one. And then my teacher kicked me out. he said, you'd better just stay there.
So that's how you ended up
in
Korea. Anybody, any questions for Soasim? Anything, any kind of question at all? Practice? Yeah.
Facing a lot of challenges along this path, do you ever think of giving up at any point?
No, never. Actually, since the day when I started to practice, it was like absolutely sure that's what I'm supposed to do.
So what is the actual things that will lead you like go through all this?
What's the motivation, you mean?
Motivation that keep you going.
I don't know, actually. I don't think I had any particular motivation. It just felt very correct to do what I'm doing, and sometimes I tried to kind of, I thought, well, I'm supposed to have at least some kind of doubt, you know, so
doubt about
what I'm doing. So I would try to generate this kind of doubt just to try to be honest with myself. So I would ask myself, but then I would ask myself, if I don't do this, what would I want to do? Mm. And there's nothing else that I want to do, so.
Yeah, it's kind of like, there's nothing else to do.
Yeah. It's like, there's really nothing more worthwhile to do, so just continue. Later on, actually, I saw that it actually helps people. And in the beginning, of course, when you start practicing, you just practice for whatever reason. Sometimes, of course, you feel that it helps you in some way. Otherwise, probably you wouldn't continue because you have less thinking, everything becomes more clear. But at some point, it's not enough because at some point, it's just everything is fine already. Yeah, why continue? But then if you kind of start seeing how this practice affects other people too, then it gives you kind of a different kind of motivation, that you start basically doing it for others more. And then first you kind of just share what you know, and then you see that it also helps those people. So then you start practicing to actually be able to help more. Because sometimes you also see that what you can share is not enough to help other people. So you have to kind of practice more and have more experience so that you can share more and give more. So basically, from the point when we started opening the Zen centers, that was my main motivation, basically, to continue.
Yeah.